Dear friends, we read in the book of Exodus how God remembers his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. When the sons of Abraham were reduced in slavery by the Egyptians, groaning in their slavery, they cried out for help. And from the depths of their slavery, their cry came up to God. Today, in this 21st century, we are, and we shall be, maybe soon, in a similar situation. In the middle of the great apostasy announced by our Lord, by Saint Paul, and by Saint John in the Apocalypse, God looked down upon his sons and he knew their misery and sufferings. He never forgets us. For instance, during the First World War in France, in Britain, they were on the edge of an invasion by the enemies. And then the Blessed Virgin Mary in Pune appeared to little children. And these words were written in the sky. But do pray, my children, my son, let himself be touched, moved by your prayers. And the general of the enemies could not understand how he had to stop moving forward with his army. And some days later, the war was over. These are historic facts. In 1918, near Laval, quite near of Pune, and all the young people who were at war come back to their city. This is a well-known miracle amongst the Catholics in Europe. And many pilgrims visit today the shrine of Our Lady of Pune. God called Moses to him from the middle of the bush blazing. "Moses, Moses," said the Lord, "come no nearer, for the place on which you stand is holy ground." And this is the case of this church, of all the church, but we are invited by God to come near by him. "I am the God of your father. I have seen the miserable state of my people. I have heard their appeal to be free of their slave drivers. Yes, I am well aware of their sufferings. The cry of my sons has come to me, and I have witnessed the way in which their enemies oppress them. After you have led the people out of Egypt, you are to offer worship to God on this mountain, and I will be your God. You are to make me an altar and sacrifice on this altar the holocausts and communion sacrifices. In every place in which you have my name remembered, that means worship in these particular places, churches, like this new church we have just Benedict, I shall come to you and I bless you in that place. The holiness of the faithful comes from the presence of the Lord in their midst, guiding and sanctifying them. The holiness of the sanctuary is shown by its elaborate exclusions and special and designated servants. The Ark of the Covenant was the most sacred part of the sanctuary. It contains the testimony, the record of the covenant. It was in the Old Covenant the most prized symbol of God's presence. It disappeared because of the prevarication of the people. In the first sack of the temple and the city of Jerusalem, and later the temple was destroyed because of the prevarication, the lack of faith of the people and of the hierarchy of the old covenant. And today it has not been reconstructed. The Lord told Moses, build me a sanctuary, a church, so that I may dwell among them. In making the tabernacle and his furnishings, you must follow exactly the pattern I shall show you. And we read in this history all the details of the benediction of the temple that God asks, and the details of the vestments of the high priest, the details of his ephod, the sign of his responsibility. You are to make me an ark of acacia wood, that was what is now our tabernacle. You are to plate it inside and out with pure gold. For the two ends of this throne of mercy, you are to make two golden cherubs, two angels. These two angels are to have their wings spread upwards. They must face one another, their faces towards the throne of mercy. These words of God in the Bible contradict the Protestant heresy against the images of the saints, of our Lord and our Lady. There, in this place, says God, I shall come. I shall come to meet you. There, from above this throne of mercy, I shall give you all my commands. It is, too, in this church that God will let us know his will for our lives. It is a place where, says the Saint Curé of Ars, I notify him, our Lord, and where he notifies me. The best place, it is the best place to maintain a conversation with God, a meditation. But this wonderful work, this building, was not an easy task. All the contrary. It is the work or very few courageous people. God will sense them in many ways. Difficult because you are the little flock about which our Lord said, "Shall I encounter any face on the earth when I shall come back?" You will be hatred by all men, including men of church. They will excommunicate you on account of my name, but not a hair of your head will be lost. Your endurance will win you your lives and your eternal life. Only the few who will remain faithful, the very few who will keep the true faith in these days, will be saved. When these things begin to take place, stand erect, hold your heads high, because your liberation is at hand. Then, as we read in the book of the Revelation, the one sitting on the throne spoke, "Now I am making the whole of creations new." And that is what we are waiting for. And this will be the fulfillment of the promise of Our Lady in Fatima. In the end of this tremendous crisis, my heart, my immaculate heart, will triumph. After this total eclipse of the Church, the sun will shine as it shined in Fatima, as never before. Of course, the countries who had more difficulties to maintain the faith, and so many martyrs, are the countries who are keeping more the faith. We can think of Mexico, where the Cristeros were shot, shouting, "Viva Cristo Rey!" And for instance, La Vendée in France, where we had our seminary, and where 300,000 Catholics were killed by the French Revolution. And of course, Ireland, who has suffered so much for so many centuries. So we must be confident in Our Lady, and that she will keep us with the faith and the charity in the middle of this apostasy, general apostasy. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.